Hello, everybody. My name is Joseph Chen. I'm the director of the Center for Critical Korean Studies here at UCI, CCKS. Today we have a really a special guest, I would say. Michelle Cho is an assistant professor of East Asian popular culture and graduate faculty in the cinema studies at the University of Toronto. She's published on Asian cinemas and Korean wave television, video, and pop music in such venues as Cinema Journal, the International Journal of Communication, Asian Video Cultures, the Korean Popular Culture Reader. Her first monograph analyzes millennial South Korean genre cinemas, and her current project theorizes vicariousness in the convergence of platforms, affect, and the globalization fantasies characteristic of K-pop's participatory culture. Her writing on K-pop fandom and media convergence can also be found online at flowjournal.org, pandemicmedia.messen.press, and the Los Angeles Review of Books. And she's also a graduate of UCI. So this is a bit of a homecoming for Michelle. I think I first met Michelle when I gave a talk years and years ago at UCI when I was not a faculty member there. So the only thing that makes me sad about this otherwise joyous occasion is that we couldn't be here in person on campus. But hopefully we can remedy that in the near future. In the meantime, let me turn it over to Michelle and she'll be giving her paper. I will say by way of housekeeping that we'll be using the Q&A function for questions after Michelle's talk. And so if you have a question, please put it there and I will read it aloud. So without further ado, let me turn it over to Michelle.
Great. Thank you so much, Joe. It's great to be here. And this is an exciting occasion for me to present at UCI, which even though we're remote, it does feel like a homecoming of sorts. So I'm really, really happy to do this. And I am also really grateful that a lot of you are here to spend your time in the afternoon / evening or morning or wherever you are. So I definitely appreciate that. I am going to start sharing my screen because I have a presentation, and I'm actually going to start off with a video. And hopefully this isn't too laggy. I know that sharing video on Zoom is sometimes a little bit tricky, but I am going to take the luxury, I guess, of having this time to kind of talk about this stuff with all of you, to share the full video that I'm going to be kind of focusing on the most here. So this talk comes out of a piece of writing that I did a couple months ago, I guess, and that was published in the Los Angeles Review of Books. So the argument hasn't really changed, but I do have a bit more space and time here today to kind of show you examples and to expand on my thinking, or so I hope. So I really look forward to hearing what you all think, your feedback and your comments in this webinar format. Thank you in advance for any thoughts and suggestions that you have on this material. Okay, so we're gonna start off with this video, and it's a bit long, but I am gonna have us watch the whole thing. Okay, here we go. Okay, so I hope you all enjoyed that. I'm going to start reading my paper now. So the remarkable staging of K-pop group BTS's televised performance of their single Life Goes on the Late Late Show with James Corden, keeps its technical tricks quite modest until the 1 minute 22 second mark, when the group convenes for its first chorus. Group member Jungkook appears doubled in the frame. So you see here, he's there twice in an otherwise sort of naturalistic or seemingly kind of simple television set. So the clip begins with the camera tracking backwards through a generic living room set. There's an oddly naked Christmas tree in the corner, but otherwise nothing remarkable until the camera passes through the sliver of space between two closed French doors. This digital effect suggests that we're watching more than just a run-of-the-mill TV set and ties the clip into an intertextual lineage of televised holiday music performances featuring French door aesthetics, the most famous of which might be Nat King Cole's 1963 rendition of the Christmas song on the Danny Kaye Show. So I have a short clip of this that I'm going to play here quickly, and hopefully you'll see what I mean.
And so I'm offering this simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you.
So I decided to edit that clip a bit to show you that ending part, because there is a kind of similarity in terms of the way that what's behind the doors starts to shift from, you know, a home setting that's decorated for Christmas into something like an outdoor space. So that bringing the outdoors indoors and that kind of liminality that's being staged there is, I think, very similar to what's going on in the Life Goes On clip. And I would argue that, you know, this performance has to have been some kind of reference point. But so to go back to Life Goes on the Late Late Show, once we're through the door, so once we're through that kind of sliver of the door, which is a digital effect, we're in an identical room, or rather the room repeats with the continuous and steady backwards camera movement. The tracking shot out reveals the BTS members in turn as they deliver their parts in the song's opening verse. Suddenly, you realize that you're traveling through the visual trope of mise en abyme, but with an important twist. Rather than the illusion of an infinitely recursive space, we see a diachronic series of incremental revelations and cumulative activity. Seasonal decor and improbable weather signal the passage of time. In one room, low-key lighting shifts into lightning flashes and rainfall as group leader RM delivers verse lines that compare the pandemic to a ceaseless storm. What changes in the room are its contents, a plant here, some snowflakes there, but never its architecture, the better to portray the BTS members' confinement to this stretched and repeated simulacrum of home that also feels like a hall of mirrors. It's hard to imagine a more precise visual representation of pandemic time, but here it is, and all of this has been painstakingly constructed for a musical performance segment on late night television. BTS last visited Corden's show in February 2020 when they filmed a live in-studio performance of their single Black Swan and a segment of the popular web-only Carpool Karaoke series for the Late Late Show's YouTube channel. In these pre-pandemic appearances, the group members were emphatically, concretely present, unlike in guest spots that they've performed remotely ever since. Yet the last year has seen the group appear more often in American print media and TV and on TV than ever before, to repeatedly make the case for their convincing crossover into the US mainstream pop landscape via coverage in legacy media outlets. The latter seek better cross-platform integration, that is network TV on YouTube, by capitalizing on the group's passionate, massive, and very online fandom. COVID-19 has accelerated cord cutting, and in this arena, as well as others, the pandemic's long-term impacts will reveal themselves for years to come. BTS's performance on Corden is a pay-in to nostalgia, both a longing for the recent pre-pandemic past and a claim to inheriting and perhaps revising the legacies of American popular music on television. In what follows, I'll argue that BTS's performances on American TV prompt us to go back to television and popular music history to see what BTS's reenactment of mid-20th century variety show aesthetics and Cold War Americana allows us to perceive and thus question today. Ultimately, I want to suggest that BTS's visibility in mainstream media outlets evokes the racial history of American pop in a way that allows us to read the group's remix strategy beyond mere imitation or appropriation, especially given a global media scape in pandemic flux.
February 9th.
I'll go back to that earlier thing in a second, but okay, so nostalgia. Nostalgia is a structure of feeling and a commercial aesthetic that's ubiquitous in late capitalism. In both its spatial and temporal modes of homesickness and a longing for the past, nostalgia is widely remarked to be a response to uncertainty, a desire for comfort in dark times. In the context of American politics today, we see competing versions. There's the poisonous revanchism of the Trump cult, which filters the 1950s through a tacky 80s tabloid brand. Biden's Build Back Better is also a nostalgic vision, but one that takes us to different post-crisis moments by telescoping the Great Depression and the Great Recession. If the 1980s political and popular culture aesthetics presented nostalgia for the 1950s, with Ronald Reagan's election being the signal example of this phenomenon, the aesthetics of the last 4 years express nostalgia for that nostalgia. So let me explain. Trumpism invokes Reaganism, which was already nostalgia transformed into ideological support for the social Darwinist fantasies of Cold War neoliberalism. Today's more wide-ranging pop nostalgic aesthetics are born of a planetary crisis that makes looking ahead a problem, but also contends with the growing acknowledgement that the past was demonstrably unlivable for the many who were shut out of the 50s idol, whose newly audible voices claim humanity in the present. What's known about that putative golden age of post-war prosperity that was beamed around the world through pop music, Hollywood film, and especially television, is that it was an Eden for a select few. So nostalgia today, either for the 1950s or the 1980s, is monstrous. And yet the iconography of Americana that saturated popular media throughout the Cold War maintains its affective force. Today's nostalgia struggles to contain the impolitic longing for McLuhan's fantasized global TV village in the mid 20th century, but perhaps it also does something else. So just to explain the two images that you see here, one of them is just a still from Back to the Future, a film that came out in 1984 and was very much about this 50s nostalgia. And then on the bottom right, a screenshot from Michael Jackson's Thriller, a music video, which was also a short film, which shows Michael Jackson in the role of a 1950s teeny bopper. Or with a teeny bopper and sort of playing these 1950s teenagers. I'm gonna say much more about the bottom right image a little bit later, but these are two examples of 1980s nostalgia for the 50s. So I want to dwell on television as global TV, which was deliberately deployed as a tool of American empire throughout the Cold War. Sorry. This is another kind of example of this 1980s, 1950s, or 2016 to 20, which was nostalgic for the 80s, which was nostalgic for the 50s. Global TV. I want to dwell on television as global TV because I noticed its return in an unexpected setting, that is BTS's televised performances. The group and its large international fandom routinely make headlines, sometimes standing in for the entirety of Gen Z, even though the BTS army, the group's official fandom, is far more diverse in age, gender, race, and nationality than most observers recognize. While the group has had a foothold on American pop charts for several years, their visibility reached a new apex in 2020 with 3 number one hit singles. There's an atavistic prestige to truly mass cultural stardom, and BTS now garners breathless praise rather than racist microaggressions from mainstream journalists. Outlets like Time, Esquire, Variety, and even the Wall Street Journal magazine have boarded the bandwagon, aiming to explain for the umpteenth time the it factor that makes the group simultaneously edgy and approachable. Despite BTS's canceled 2020 world tour, The group has been more visible in American mass media in the last year than ever before. To repeatedly make the case for their convincing crossover into the US mainstream pop landscape. Live televised performance has been the engine of BTS's crossover, at least in the testimony of many BTS converts. Sorry, I'm not going to read these slides with the definition sort of global TV, but I just wanted to note that this is a term that's been used by historians to describe what both lawmakers and network or TV industry people envisioned as the purpose of exporting American television to other parts of the world during the Cold War. It was really as a way to kind of foster the desire for an American style lifestyle in all of these other places as one tool in fighting the ideological war that was, you know, the primary arena of battle during the Cold War. Okay, so BTS's television strategy harkens back to earlier eras of American entertainment spectacle pioneered by vaudeville and later television variety shows. The group's term offensive across the big three networks has been thorough, scoring high profile guest spots on The Late Show with James Corden, The Tonight Show starring Jimmy Fallon, SNL, and Good Morning America, in addition to Colbert's show, Kimmel's show. They've now also kind of made appearances on MTV Unplugged, as well as NPR Tiny Desk Concert. So they're really kind of pursuing or able to book those spots across the mediascape. The group has also performed on every televised music show in the US media market, the American Music Awards, the Billboard Music Awards, the MTV Video Music Awards, and the Grammys. In the latter case, BTS first appeared as special guests during Lil Nas X's performance of his 2019 hit Old Town Road, rather than performing their own music and choreography. This year, even though the group headlined the telecast, they were passed over for their award category. Thus, recognition from the Recording Academy as music professionals rather than just dancing Asian bodies remains the group's Everest. So BTS's television performances highlight technical mastery and intertextual aesthetics, which presents a somewhat contradictory appeal to viewers, which is very unlike the media strategy of their Anglo-American contemporaries, their peers, I guess, in the American popular music market, aim instead for radio play and platform ubiquity on Spotify or iTunes. So BTS instead lean into their polished performance repertoire, despite the risk of reinforcing the image of K-pop that supports the racist view of Asian bodies as robotic, unassimilable, and perpetually foreign. Because the group also dominates all manner of digital platforms, precisely by exporting the conventions of the South Korean pop industry, which closely integrates lavishly produced TV performances with music marketing and promotion. Like other K-pop acts, BTS match eye-popping group choreography to their musical tracks, displaying star levels of charisma and athletic coordination in each televised musical number, while focusing parasocial intimacy on social media and in offstage media content. This duality appeals to almost everybody, except for a certain sort of straight white middle-aged audience in whom BTS tends to produce intense xenophobia. We just saw an example of this a couple of months ago with the German shock jock radio DJ who called BTS a virus like COVID. So this group, this kind of often male white middle-aged audience is, however, the demographic for whom a lot of late night network television is written. So notably, BTS has been a repeat guest only on Fallon and Corden, whose shows emphasize pop musicality and playful millennial energy, in contrast to those of Stephen Colbert, Seth Meyers, and Jimmy Kimmel, which have centered on political commentary, especially since the Trump era began. As Benjamin M. Hahn details in Beyond the Black and White TV, Asian and Latin American Spectacle in Cold War America, variety television of the 1950s to 1970s frequently featured, quote, ethnic spectacle. Oh, sorry, I had an image here of BTS's appearance on Stephen Colbert in 2019, which explicitly referenced the Beatles' first appearance on the Ed Sullivan Show in 1964. And so this is another example of this kind of mid-century or Cold War TV aesthetic that in this case, I think was scripted by the writers for Colbert's show. But you can kind of see how, you know, this airplane, the deplaning of the Beatles at JFK Airport was the site of a lot of fan activity, of course. And so I think there's also a kind of citation of that moment in the BTS Dynamite performance that I showed you at the very beginning. Okay. So, oops. Ethnic spectacle. Okay, so these were musical performances by Asian and Latinx performers, which were shown to in order to assert an ideology of globalism for an imagined overseas audience. This was part of the uptake by commercial television producers of an anti-communist multicultural vision of America achieved through popular music and entertainment spectacle. The strategy aligned with attempts to mitigate Soviet criticisms of US anti-Black racism, which were on vivid display in the civil rights struggle, with State Department funded tours that sent artists like Louis Armstrong and Dizzy Gillespie around the world as jazz ambassadors. While the function of diversity in musical performance on television no longer hews to the Cold War dualism, late night TV still seems to govern the Overton window of what counts as part of the national zeitgeist, which BTS's American reception makes clear. If Kimmel retains Vaudeville's ethnic sidekick, and notably when BTS appeared on his show in 2018, the group shared language lessons with parking lot security guard turned regular cast member Guillermo Rodriguez. Jimmy Fallon revises mid-century variety show cultural politics by highlighting the iconoclasm of foreign language musical performers on his show. So I was just actually looking for this clip again on YouTube this afternoon because it was originally uploaded as like one of the extra features for the Jimmy Kimmel YouTube channel, which is something that a lot of late night TV and other television shows are doing, is supplementing their kind of network presence with YouTube content because they're trying to reach audiences across these different spaces where people consume media. But it's been taken down or I couldn't find it. So another fan though had already uploaded it with Spanish subtitles, which I think is great. So I was able to capture an image of it here. Okay, so despite truisms about the power of pop music to transcend cultural and linguistic barriers, television's spectacular function remains a keystone of BTS's publicity strategy because the group gets limited radio play for their Korean language tracks, which constitute the lion's share of their output. Their sole track sung entirely in English is last summer's retro disco pop hit, Dynamite. Dynamite's overt superficiality and its outlier status in the group's discography laid bare the xenophobia of US music industry gatekeepers as it became their first track to hit the elusive number one spot on the Billboard Hot 100 singles chart, in no small part because it was the first of BTS's songs to receive substantial radio play. However, the group's subsequent Korean language single, Life Goes On, also rose to the top spot despite its near total exclusion from radio airwaves in the US, a testament to the steady growth of their fandom, whose ARMY acronym, ARMY, for those of you who don't know, despite its kind of military connotations, stands for Adorable Representative MC for Youth. So there's a term for a BTS fan who discovered the group during COVID, that is Pandemic ARMY. And ARMY's ranks are expanding apace of the group's prolific transmedia engagement. seen in this light, the television performance of Dynamite on Corden's show from November 2020 takes on a sharpened significance as a retort to the era of American cultural imperialism via global TV. BTS exit a trailer, dance across the tarmac, board a jet in first class, and deplane straight onto a simulacrum of Corden's LA studio stage, topped by its Late Late Show marquee. The final segment of the performance takes place on a copy of the interview set, complete with piped-in sounds of a faux studio audience. The only element that can't be fabricated is, of course, Corden himself, who remains absent from the scene. Instead, the famously hammy group member, Jimin, takes a seat in James's chair behind his interview desk before joining the rest of the group members for the song's closing bars as they add a realist touch, the staple awkward musical interlude shuffle. Dynamite is a simulacrum of American pop, which is exported and sold around the world. So how fitting that the performance would stage the group's most commercial track as a virtual movement of cargo via trailer and shipping container from Seoul to LA. But the performance also, again, cites American mid-century variety television, which often used the trope of tourist mobility in special episodes shot abroad or segments that simulated international flights when air travel for most Americans offered a fantasy of glamour and luxury. So this is Ed Sullivan. He's actually on a naval ship. So he's kind of taping his show. And Ed Sullivan is a famous variety show host from the mid-century US TV landscape. So I found this image resonant because he's kind of standing on a air pad in a similar way that BTS appear in their staging of the video. Okay, so while their performance of Dynamite dematerializes the Pacific Ocean expanse that separates Seoul and Los Angeles, it nonetheless affirms the significance of place. It's important that we know that BTS travel via Incheon International Airport on their nation's flagship carrier, Korea Air. As the group transforms what's possible in the realm of mediated live performance on American TV, BTS also draws attention to the difference that place makes, even or especially in the realm of remote content creation under pandemic constraints. In the jumbled collage of Americana, that is their Dynamite music video, which I'm gonna talk about more from here forward, BTS deploy a series of nostalgic locations that mash up millennial pop culture's mid-century cliches. The teenager's bedroom, the donut shop slash diner, the record store, plus a roller rink turned discotheque. There's also a 90s Space Jam segment on a basketball court and a Teletubbies inspired chorus. So what may seem like mere postmodern monstrosity is actually a commentary on the pleasures and perils of nostalgia, as well as a subtle nod to the racial history of the pop crossover. I was looking at the Dynamite video again and just saw that it has over a billion YouTube views. So I don't know when that happened, but it's been a very, very popular video, as you can see. BTS was nominated for their first Grammy in the category of Best Pop Duo / Group Performance, not for their 2020 magnum opus, Map of the Soul 7, a genre experimenting LP that offered a career culminating statement on their 7-year history. Instead, their nomination was for Dynamite, a track that was chosen by their US distributor, Columbia, specifically to engineer a crossover hit. In addition to the comfortingly pastel sets, the group choreography is also surprisingly familiar. Throughout the music video, the group spells out its debt to the king of pop and first crossover teen idol sensation Michael Jackson by moonwalking across the set. However, the influence of MJ's televisual presence only becomes clear when comparing the movements of the Dynamite choreography with Jackson's famed live performance of Billie Jean on the 1983 TV special 25 Motown, Yesterday, Today, and Forever, where he first debuted the moonwalk. So I'm just going to show you some of that now. So you can maybe see the connections between BTS's choreography and Michael Jackson's. Okay, so this is Michael Jackson in this television special. Had to show you that kick at the end because, of course, that comes up frequently in the BTS Dynamite choreography. Okay, so let's see. So highlighting MJ's stylized miming of the 50s greaser combing his hair, Dynamite's dance moves place BTS in a genealogy of crossover musicians, which deliberately points to American pop's history of deracination. As Michael D. Dwyer notes in Back to the 50s, Nostalgia, Hollywood Film, and Popular Music of the 70s and 80s, Michael Jackson repeatedly appealed to 50s teen idol culture to accomplish his crossover from Motown phenom to mainstream pop star, specifically operationalizing the music video form, despite its explicitly anti-Black MTV platform. So again, this is the image that I had included earlier of Michael Jackson kind of in the beginning of the Thriller music video, where he's on a date with a woman and they are dressed like 1950s teenagers. She has like bobby socks and the poodle skirt, and he has a Letterman jacket. And then he turns into a werewolf, and the video kind of becomes a parody of the also mid-century horror B-movies that were either played in theaters or sometimes the horror kind of anthology TV series that were played on TV. So throughout, there is this kind of nostalgic performance happening, but it's very curious the way that Michael Jackson is using this kind of image of the all-American teen from the 1950s in order to move away from his association with music that is specifically catered to a Black audience. Okay, so by neutralizing his Blackness using tropes of white Americana while highlighting the uniqueness of his stage presence and especially dance skills, Michael Jackson achieved dominance in the field of American pop, both domestically and globally. This gesture was both visible and invisible, giving rise to an enduring fascination, almost an obsession, over Jackson's racial instability or boundary crossing. As musicologist David Brackett notes, the term crossover usually describes how an artist's appeal transcends an audience associated with one type of music to include another, with some reference often made to the role of musical and visual factors in the process, reminding us that musical categories are undeniably linked to racial identity and social meanings. The division of musical genres can sometimes shore up myths of stable identity and clear boundaries between them, especially when they become crystallized by institutional practices, including radio formats, critical discussion in journalistic and fan discourse. Michael Jackson's ubiquitous label, crossover artist, was used for at least 40 years, which is one of the ways that he achieved this status as the king of pop. So this, I'm trying to argue here that this kind of racial history of the pop crossover, and especially Michael Jackson's role in it, is a history that BTS are referencing very deliberately. In a way, what this does is draw our attention to the way that pop has been understood as a cultural form that requires the perceived shedding of racial identity as a limit to mass appeal. Ironically, social and cultural hybridity in American pop music, which has always been a blend of other genres, mixes to a homogeneous whiteness. What endures across the pop culture landscape is the way that a pre-civil rights image of Americana secures mainstream pop as invisibly racialized. In other words, what's undeniable to us now is the whiteness of Reagan-era nostalgia. And that is what passed as American culture writ large, both at home and importantly, in the many overseas markets in which American popular culture circulated, and which I argue now that BTS helps to make visible. So by framing the question of pop nostalgia transnationally, I think we necessarily change the ways in which we read nostalgia's rhetorical gestures as they signify differently to geographically distinct audience. Unfortunately, this is a point that was largely missed by pop industry gatekeepers at the Recording Academy, which again, BTS performed at remotely last month. Incidentally, the show was newly helmed by producer Ben Winston, who co-created Carpool Karaoke when he worked on The Late Late Show with James Corden, and who tweeted admiration for the Corden performance that I've been talking about here. BTS's Grammy nomination has a crucial context that goes beyond thirst for recognition from US pop industry peers. They've been running up against a hard deadline, that is their mandatory conscription in South Korea's military, which is one of the many enduring traces of the Cold War that remain in South Korean society. BTS's oldest member was due to enlist on his 28th birthday on December 4th, 2020, which would have required the group to reshuffle the 7-member lineup to which fans are deeply attached. South Korea's National Assembly came to the rescue in the nick of time, passing a revision to the Military Service Act to grant a 2-year deferral for high-profile popular artists so that Jin could remain a BTS member through the other side of the pandemic. This deferral provision is being called the BTS law in South Korea and attests to shifting ideas about culture industries, as many in the Korean public regard BTS's celebrity as a form of national service. So BTS's use of the old school medium of network television and its integration of music performance as mainstream entertainment keeps alive a notion of a broad global public that was codified during the Cold War and which has been lost with audience fragmentation and narrowcasting. This suggests that the key modifier of globalism today is its virtuality, a point that is also old school. So this harks back to the nostalgic mid-20th century vision of fantasized mobility and the kind of global connectedness that was suddenly going to be possible through technologies like television. At this point, our virtual globalism is a response to the material crises of our present moment. The group's large international fandom certainly exceeds the scope of the US, but so does American television's reach and its aspirations to the universality of its bourgeois liberal, and in the case of late night TV, often blatantly patriarchal, world horizons. While there are other examples of televised pop music performance with comparable aims to broad public reception, for example, the Super Bowl halftime show, BTS's targeted conquest of American TV viewership is a throwback to an older model of networked televisual connection, but in a moment in which such connections signify different boundaries and geopolitical dynamics than the last time an Asian language single performed by an Asian national ended up at the top of the Billboard charts. That is, in 1963. Kyu Sakamoto's Ue o Muite Aruko, rechristened with the rather arbitrary title Sukiyaki in its US release, rose to the top spot as a Cold War Orientalist fluke. I mean, it's a good song, but I think that it was rather just a trend. This was before the 1965 Immigration Act that finally overturned explicitly racialized restrictions on Asian migration. So if BTS embody nostalgia, both in the content of their oeuvre and the media forms they've harnessed to achieve pop stardom, their North American reception may also point us to the horizons of post-pandemic futures. Mainstreaming foreign languages in mass media and decentering US players is important, even if the forms on offer are reassuringly familiar. BTS are meaningfully disruptive in their language of expression and their provenance outside the circuits of Euro-American pop industries. Broadcast TV's and print media's desperate attraction to BTS in order to speak to the group's enormous fan base suggests that old media are looking to social media, internet video, micro-celebrity, and influencer culture for a lifeline. But the very institutional quality of old media explains why BTS are using them as a means of broadening their influence and correspondingly South Korea's. There are perhaps many geopolitical conclusions we could draw from the timing of K-pop's mainstreaming as a genre of popular entertainment in North America and BTS's meteoric rise in popularity, all of which occurred during the disasters of the Trump era and its outright falsification of US democratic ideals. But turning away from ethno-nationalist celebration of K-pop or the Korean wave, I want to end this talk with a different call for our collective attention. As we imagine a post-Trump, post-COVID future, we must resist the pull of nostalgia that Biden's promised restoration of America's global stature also represents. In this context, while BTS's US television appearances are a sign of change made possible through the group's strategic deployment of nostalgia, they also draw our attention to the difference that inheres in repetition. BTS's mediating function reminds us that there's no going back. Life goes on indeed. Thank you.
So, I'm gonna imagine thunderous applause because there are lots of people here. That was a fantastic talk. Let me open it up for Q&A. So once again, we're gonna be using the Q&A function at the bottom of the Zoom screen. Please type in your questions there and then I will read them aloud. So while people are getting questions asked, I guess I'd just start. First of all, thank you, Michelle. That was really amazing and really entertaining. I really enjoyed all of the clips in addition to the talk. I guess I just had a question about thinking about the sort of rubric of nostalgia. One of the things that that your talk made me think about was a sort of a key term was obsolescence. Mm. And the way in which BTS really interestingly negotiates obsolescence, all of the things that you're talking about, whether it's, radio or network TV or, all of these forms, they seem to be sort of in the production of this sort of virtual globalism, rather than leaning in, obviously they're online and things like that, right? But at least aesthetically leaning into what are sort of obsolete forms. Mm-hmm. So I wonder if you could talk about, is that a sort of a contradiction between obsolescence and this globalism? How do you think of obsolescence as a category within this larger, under this larger rubric?
Mm-hmm. That's such a great question. I think that I think what you're picking up on something that's really interesting about what BTS does, which is that unlike some of the other entertainment companies in the K-pop industry that have really kind of latched onto this rhetoric of post-humanist futures and really embracing the kind of techno-futuristic as their brand. I think that BTS began with this kind of, and Big Hit, now Hi-B, which is their label, they're doing the kind of platform innovation part, but that's not necessarily a big part of what BTS do as, performing artists or as, a group. they are really dedicated to this kind of idea of old school, which starts from their kind of beginnings as a hip hop idol group. And so really always pointing to their predecessors, whether that's, you know, like late 80s, early 90s gangster rap in Southern California, which is a really important kind of touchstone and influence for them, or talking about Sateji, this like really important indie youth culture beacon musician of the 90s. They're always kind of pointing backwards. So it's not so much, I feel like it's never an abject like turn or like, oh, this is outdated or it's, you know, obsolete at this point. It's always a kind of move to remediate. So to bring those things back, but then kind of integrate them, repeat them in new ways. And so I find that that is really the way that the group operates. So there's this constant kind of reinvention and, you know, you see this even in just the way that the company and the group kind of reinvents itself with new releases and sort of sheds parts of their past or earlier modes of operation without too much sentimental like attachment, really. There's no nostalgia in those parts necessarily. But then there is this kind of idea of the authenticity of the group kind of coming through this this attitude towards the past, to things that seem no longer current as a set of resources, and like the ability to remediate them in ways that suddenly make them very relevant again.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's amazing just because just to think of, you know, what it means to be a successful musical act. You know, I think, you know, it was not too long ago that people were lamenting the end of the music industry and talking mm-hmm. about, like, you know, how the old models of record sales and things like that were just no longer viable. And just to see it kind of like mastered in a totally different way to different kind of media strategy is kind of amazing. Mm-hmm. So we're starting to get questions here. Let me go this. So this is a kind of, I guess, it's about Hy-Vee and Hy-Vee's mm-hmm. Recent acquisition of Ithaca Holdings, the Scooter Braun company. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's just how the question about how this would affect media and recording for BTS and other K-pop bands, or just, I guess, thinking about just your reflections about that acquisition in general.
Yeah. I mean, it's really interesting because there is this kind of like, whoa, what's going to happen now to BTS, big hit, to K-pop, to, you know, like, it's really, there's a question about the merging, right, of these two companies that really represent a very large segment of the commodified popular music that gets sold today. In a way, I would say that, you know, Hy-Vee's acquisition of Ithaca Holdings is a very meaningful kind of symbolic gesture, but in my view, it doesn't necessarily change. I feel like it has more of an impact symbolically than really changing the way that popular music is made today, which is in this incredibly transnational manner, where because it's actually very segmented, fragmented, you know, songwriting happens via, you know, connections between people that are sending music files to each other across national borders. And, you know, like, there's already a kind of integration of lots of different people into what's like understood to be this very like local or localized industry, whether that's K-pop or whether that's American pop. So I almost feel like it's like Sony buying a Hollywood studio, you know, or something like that. Like, I don't know that it's going to necessarily change so much of what we see in the industry right away. But it is an important, again, kind of symbolic move, I would say. Like BTS really are the center of American pop in a certain sense, or the directions that it's going. Yeah.
So actually, this may be a thinking about Sony's acquisition of the Hollywood studio. This next question seems to maybe push this in a slightly different, maybe useful direction. That is there. James Lee asks: is there a parallel pivot of BTS/K-pop to China by registering not so much nostalgic affect, but maybe one that's futuristic or future oriented? I'm thinking of YouTube videos in which BTS members are engaged. Engaging Chinese language audiences. And so this is actually, interestingly, another resonance of like the crossover artists, like a different kind of crossover. Right. Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, it's pretty remarkable if you see BTS interact with Chinese audiences versus Japanese audiences versus Korean versus American. I feel like some groups tend to kind of come together as just like international army, but then there are some audiences and national markets in which they do kind of do something somewhat distinct. And I don't know, I don't know if I can say more in terms of, you know, there's the specificity of their comportment with Chinese audiences. I know that there was actually a lot of controversy over BTS's reception in China after last fall, because they had gotten an award at the Korea Society in New York City and said something about the US ROK partnership and the fact that the Korean War had happened, and then Chinese fans got really upset and started to boycott BTS. So given that kind of, I mean, it was strange, but it was.
I was at that Korea Society thing, so I'm trying to remember like if there was something controversial, but I don't remember it.
It happened afterwards, Joe. Oh, okay. It was really interesting because, Chinese fans got insulted by the reference to the Korean War because China was obviously on the opposing side as the US and the Republic of Korea. And so it created some controversy for a while. And there was a sense that, you know, like there's such volatility when you're dealing with this strategy of really fostering this global fandom, but then also localizing some of your practices for specific fan groups. And so I find that other labels, I mean, all the entire K-pop industry is definitely, you know, paying attention to the Chinese market, as are all of Korea's culture industries, all of their industries. But I think that some companies are doing it more kind of visibly and overtly, and I don't know that Hybe is one of them. Because if you look at what is newsworthy either in the US or South Korea about Hybe, it's again this like acquisition of Ithaca Holdings, the way that it is really creating a central place for itself in the West, you know, quote unquote. So I don't know if I answered that question, but I think that's what I would say for now.
So this actually, the next question maybe gives you a chance to expand and maybe take in a slightly different direction. First of all, thanks you for a wonderful talk. It asks about a possible culture conf between the US and China that is possibly heating up. Do you think something like a Cold War dualism will come back to provide new challenges to Korean artists? This is interesting because there's a kind of, you talked about Cold War nostalgia on the one hand, but also then like a kind of Cold War recursion on the other.
Hi Keegan, thank you for being here and watching the talk. You know, it's interesting. I think that, you know, your question is sort of getting at what I I'm also concerned with or kind of hesitant about in terms of the idea that, you know, Biden's presidency also takes us back to a certain kind of, you know, Washington consensus with a way of, you know, thinking about the world that will enforce these old divisions and with a kind of hawkish relationship to China or North Korea, right? That like smushes things back into this dualistic form that I think is kind of part of the problem. So I guess I see that Cold War nostalgia being both things, because if we think about the way that the whole rationale according to like Benjamin Hahn and Michael Dwyer for this kind of image of diversity on in mid-century television was in order to convince people overseas that America was better than the Soviets. You know, it was like a way of combating communism through this like happy image that didn't resemble what was going on the ground. So, I think that Korean artists have already been challenged in a number of ways because of the US-China antagonism. I mean, Thad was an example of that as well. So this is just, I think, going to continue. And that's there are certain things that really change with the end of the Trump era and the kind of, I don't know, whatever normalcy that happens going forward, but this is not one of them. And the policies were not that different. In fact, there was more of a sense of something potentially being possible under Trump with his volatility in brokering some sort of agreement with North Korea than there ever was with Obama. And I don't know about Biden. I don't think so. Yeah.
Okay. Andrew Leong asks, I'm curious about reading the remediations of early Cold War whiteness via fashion or place, the 50s poodle skirt, letter jacket, nostalgic locations, and how these understandings of whiteness overlap with readings of whiteness of skin and colorism. For example, commentary on the paleness of sugar, questions regarding skin whitening, etc.
It's such a good question, and thank you so much, Andrew, for asking it. I have thought about this kind of a lot, you know, like to what extent does a idea about the relationship between race and popular culture or pop cultural forms, like when does that also converge with like the dermis or like, you know, the idea of skin tone or colorism, questions about race that seem more physiological or phenotypical or whatever. And I think that, you know, in the comparison that I was trying to make between like the way that Jimin is directly drawing on Michael Jackson's dance moves or dance style in the Dynamite video, I think that I was trying to kind of make the argument that despite the sort of like pastel backdrop and the sort of whatever, it's a very interesting music video because it's so superficial in a way that I think is like shouting out to the viewer, like, look how constructed all of this is, you know, and I sort of like that. So despite the kind of pastel Disneyfied, you know, mise-en-scene, that there is a deliberate kind of homage and citation of Michael Jackson that also references BTS as racialized artists in the North American context, in which, you know, the whitening of the pop mainstream then becomes more visible, because, you know, no matter how, I guess, like, how many Billboard hits you get on like the Hot 100, like there's still all of this discussion about, you know, what is foreign, what is, you know, not mainstream, about BTS, at least at the level of like the kind of journalistic and critical discussion. And so, yeah, so I have not been thinking so much about the what I see as a kind of Asian discourse and context about colorism and the kind of like desire for white skin as a expression of a desire for whiteness. I think there's some way that, you know, discussions about Asian beauty standards and, you know, Hedgen Lee at NYU is doing really amazing work on these questions in terms of plastic surgery and the way that a Korean look is being sort of globalized through media platforms like YouTube. But there is a sense that there's been a shift in the racial connotations of aspects of an Asian beauty standard. They used to be understood to signify a desire for whiteness, a desire for like European, Euro-American beauty. And now they've shifted so that they're really not about looking white. It's about looking rich. And so that's maybe a different thing, especially in the context of a kind of hyper-consumerist neoliberal Asia. But yeah, these questions about, you know, where, again, these kind of cultural signs that are presented through fashion, dance moves, etc., where they intersect with like race as a biological feature are really, really interesting. And I am definitely thinking about them a lot. So thank you.
Okay. I'm getting a lot of questions, so I'm just gonna keep asking them until you get tired. And
sure.
Is there any significance of the subversive reference to the racialized past of global pop also have anything to do with the reinvention of the group as not just K-pop but broadly simply pop? Could there be a way of reading this also as a way to claim global intelligibility, mm-hmm. And if this indeed is, and distancing from common tropes in K-pop?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes. I think that the references to MJ, Michael Jackson, and this kind of you know, deracinated field of American mainstream pop is, again, also a deliberate gesture on the part of BTS to say something about where they fit in. I will say that they've never, I mean, a lot of fans are like engaged in various debates about whether BTS is K-pop. Is K-pop a restrictive category or restrictive label, because what they do kind of goes beyond what K-pop is? And there are all of these kind of complex streams of various, you know, I that is such a contentious question, because there is a sense that, you know, for some, the K in K-pop is very national or embrace of ethnic difference or embrace of like the non-hegemonic. It's even like a marker of subalternity. And then for other people, it's kind of like, you know, a way for the state, the government to kind of co-opt whatever a group is doing to kind of claim it as some sort of soft power tool or something. And so I can definitely understand the reasons why, you know, there these debates are going on, but there is also a strain of some of these discussions about whether BTS is K-pop that reflect a certain internalized racism. Like, we don't like K-pop. K-pop is embarrassing or annoying, or it's not cool, but BTS is cool. So therefore, and they don't make me uncomfortable or cringe the way that these other Asian groups do that are too Asian. So BTS has never ever asked to be considered something exceptional to K-pop, and especially in like when they were really blowing up and they're starting to really build their audience in the US after their Billboard Social Artist Award in 2017, they actually did a lot of interviews where they're like, of course we're K-pop. We come from Korea, we sing in Korean, we are part of this industry. And so why is that a question? And so I think they may be revising those questions now to say like, we are K-pop, but we're also pop. and maybe that's what they're doing in their citation of MJ. I think what's interesting too about Michael Jackson and their affinity for Michael Jackson is that he, as an artist, was like infantilized, right? Considered to be a child forever. And this is something that BTS, as Asian male performers and also K-pop artists, also have to deal with this kind of you're forever a child. And so I think just the kind of resonances are really, really interesting. And so I think their gesture is, I think, multifaceted in its meaning.
If I could interject, because and maybe sum up some of these questions, it seems like a lot of the questions are kind of getting at a very kind of basic question about reading kind of intentionality into these gestures that seem, on the one hand, like appropriation or citation. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, like, I apologize if you already kind of gave this at the beginning, but I kind of like didn't really fully sort of realize the argument until after you'd been done talking about it. But the opening reading of the Life Goes On, and specifically the way Mizen Abim becomes like something else, instead of recursion and reflection, you get like refraction and change and sort of a diachronic process rather than like a kind of inward folding one. Is there something to be read there in terms of like, are you suggesting that signals something about its relationship to previous images, its relationship to you know, the sort of the matter of culture that it's recycling and then, you know, sort of reappropriating? Does that is that a site of like, you know, where you can read some kind of intention or something?
Totally. Yeah, that's so helpful. I really appreciate that, Joe, because I think that
you were saying that already. I'm sorry.
I think I was, but I like didn't make that very clear. I didn't make the connection clear, or I didn't even actually think it in a clear way until you said it. But yeah, I mean, that is kind of what I'm trying to get at, is that I don't think that my argument is about what BTS intend or what their company intends or what they are, you know, like what they are consciously sort of doing when they are intertextual, because that is just their practice. And that, frankly, is the way that K-pop works, is that it is hyper intertextual. I don't know. I don't want to say hypertextual because that's the wrong word, but you know, there's this like accumulation of reference points always. And that's also by design, because that helps fans and people who are interested in the content to it gives them like their own role in this, which is to interpret and decode. And that's a really important part of the bond of the bond between fans and artists. I think what I'm trying to do here is talk about the ways that what BTS is doing, regardless of conscious intent or not, allows us, fans, scholars, interpreters, I guess, to think about things differently. Like, what's different about the gesture of repeating, or like referencing these mid-century tropes. It's not just stylish. It's like, you know, BTS are doing something different than what Mad Men was doing in kind of romanticizing the mid-century milieu, you know.
Yeah, I guess the word intentionality was badly chosen. All I meant to suggest was that there seems to be, like, what that little device does throughout that section of the video does is turn a spatial relation into a temporal relation. Mm. Well, just to be sort of like overly Jamesonian about it, but
yes,
it
yes.
Just so instead of like the sort of the prototypical hall of mirrors that we think of Mizuno being, yeah. It's actually like it actually happens in time, like time mm-hmm. passes, right? And that seems like an important difference. Anyway.
Yes.
All right. So I'm going to like stop and then go back to the questions. So what are your thoughts about the Korean music industry catering to Western audience through Western-centric nostalgia, general aesthetics, or the rise of English lyrics like Rose from Blackpink's single or Monstack's English album as a form of assimilation, as opposed to creating a bridge between the two music industries through traditional Korean pop music? Mm. It's an interesting counterpoint to some of the things we've been talking about.
Yeah. I mean, so one thing that I would say about the nostalgia that, like the nostalgia for the global as it was imagined in the early Cold War, is that I think what I'm trying to get at is that this is nostalgia that, yes, refers to like American television images, but that was disseminated a lot of places. And so actually, if you look at what, like there are other examples of nostalgia for a similar period, or maybe like the 70s sometimes, in Korean films and also other music videos, and it's the same aesthetics. this, the hairstyles, the fashion. I remember the first time I saw a music video by Girls' Generation called Genie, 소원을 말해봐. It's like really strange because there's this interlude where you see the group in a bunch of military uniforms and you're like, wait, you were just like a bunch of teenage girls like at a slumber party, and then now suddenly you're at the military variety show. Like, what is that? And I think it's kind of referencing these nostalgia aesthetics as well. But that was for, you know, an Asian audience primarily. Although, you know, Girls' Generation definitely has fans all around the world. The image, the setting would have resonated very differently for those audiences. So I guess I would say that these nostalgic aesthetics, I don't think they're only targeting or activating nostalgia within a quote unquote Western audience. I think that they're pointing to the way that our structures of feeling are coming from a media history that is quite global, actually, but the images in circulation, they are coming from centers of media production and hegemony. So yeah, so yes, it's a similar kind of repository of images or tropes, but then again, they operate differently in different places.
Okay, I think we have time just for one last question, and here's a very appropriate one. And you did broach this a little bit about, this is a COVID question, mm-hmm. and I guess in relationship to the Life Goes On videos. So any thoughts about filtered nostalgia for pre-COVID era presidents, say the Life Goes On video? It's clear that the video is supposed to centralize a kind of collective grief for what we're all supposedly missing. So yeah, I mean, and I guess if I could just append a little part to that, is just, I guess, thinking about not just nostalgia for a pre-COVID era, but just sort of like what, how you think that video engages, the pandemic, and thinking about the I think you talked about this, not just as the pandemic, as like, as signaling a desire to return to normal, but to think about other kinds of changes that the pandemic kind of hastens that were already changing or not, right?
Mm-hmm. So. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think that, so I love that performance, the Life Goes On performance, so much, because I think it's doing so many things at once. And what I find really interesting about it is, like, again, the way that it transitions into the Dynamite performance. What's happening is that, so there's this very, like, kind of melancholy feeling and tone, and the repetition, and this kind of like feeling boxed in. And then the last few rooms involve the group actually like changing clothes and getting into their stage costumes or stage clothes for their Dynamite performance. But that's staged as a nostalgic memory of kind of choosing their, or getting ready for a live performance. And so that's the thing that is also kind of being mourned as lost. And that's also the point where the performance gets a bit more specific. It's in its mode of address. So it shifts a little bit away from a kind of like general television viewing public or internet viewing public. And then it shifts a little bit more to their fandom. So now we're talking to like our fans, those of you who remember seeing us or being able to see us in live performance contexts, and how that's a sense of like mass intimacy that has been really lost. So I think that is just such an interesting way to kind of move the performance, so that it's like you get the idea, it repeats, and you're like, okay, now I get it, and then it then shifts and there's a new idea that's introduced. And so I kind of forget the question, but I knew that I was like the general versus something more specific.
Yeah, but I mean, I think you answered it. It's just sort of a question about its relationship to, to the pandemic. So
yes, right. Yeah, I mean, I think what's interesting is that, like, again, I got interested in this video because I was like, yeah, I'm nostalgic for what things were like before this happened, but at the same time, what was going on before the pandemic was like a horribleness of Trump, late Trump, when the fear that he would be reelected and that things would really go, like, I mean, even more off the rails than they already are, was an omnipresent thing in my life. I was like waking up every day and being like, we just gotta like get through this, but what's gonna happen? There's a dread. And so the immediate pre-pandemic is not fun to think about as a time that I would want to go back to, nor is, I don't know, like, I don't want to go back to 2015 either, because there was a lot of stuff that was not visible, that was not, that there was a lot of stuff that we have been able to talk about and kind of find legitimacy for, right? Ideas like Black Lives Matter, like, this, I think that in the Obama days, we were kind of stuck in this weird kind of post-racial space that I don't think is a good idea to go back to. No. So yeah, there is that dilemma of like, so what is it that we long for if the past doesn't really offer much knowing what we know now? So.
Well, on that note, I want to thank you. First of all, I apologize to all of the, on that really cheer. Sorry. So what you're saying is that there's literally not a year that you could think about wanting to go back to.
No. I would want to go back to, I think 2017 was probably like a good year in my fandom journey.
Uh-huh.
But also that fandom was motivated in some ways by what was like the disaster that was happening more broadly, right? In the country, in North America.
So thanks. I apologize to those who asked a question that we couldn't get to. We were sort of overwhelmed with questions. There was one sort of repeated question about whether or not this will be posted. It will be posted on the CCKS YouTube channel, so you can watch it there. And as well, if I could plug all of our other previous events, the many things, cool things are up there. And then finally, just want to thank Michelle for a really wonderful talk and a really engaging discussion. You know, I'm just sad that we can't like take you out for Korean food now, or, you know, pressing the end button on a Zoom talk is so sad.
I know.
Stick around. Same. For a while. We'll stop recording and then we'll follow up. But thank you, everybody, for coming. We really appreciate it.